My name is Alexander Coulter. I'm the president of the Secular Students Alliance student group here at the University of Michigan. And for those of you who haven't heard of us or haven't visited our group yet during our weekly meetings, we are the only student group on campus that caters to non-religious students. Our main goals are basically to provide a community for those students and also to promote secular values, including separation of church and state, and free thought and critical thinking. Part of what we do to help promote those goals is events like these, where we will invite speakers like Jerry to come and talk about their own experiences, both within different religious communities, and also how they have dealt with coming out as an atheist, and how they have dealt with people who they've known all their life as being religious. I'll give the mic up to Jen shortly so she can introduce Jared, but some introductory information on some of the events that we also have coming up in our SSA. This upcoming Saturday is the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society's Light the Night Walk at the DT Edison Center over on Packard and Maine. The Light the Night Walk is something that the secular community has taken up and sort of within the past year or two help to really raise money for to help combat cancer. And our Secular Student Alliance has formed a team with the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society as a fundraiser. So I'm not allowed to ask for donations tonight, but if you guys are interested, we do have a team website, and we can give you more information about that at our table outside, and you can go visit there to consider donating if you're interested. Also, we have our weekly meetings regularly every Thursday at about this time, starting at 7 o'clock in 807 Denison, and those are open to the public, and you can feel free to stop by if you guys have time at 7 o'clock and come discuss our different weekly topics. This upcoming week, we're going to be discussing religion and relationships, and religion and parenting. And that's something that's usually got a really good discussion going within our group, because a lot of people have different opinions on how relationships can work when one group is religious or one group is not religious. And a lot of arguments will usually start that way. And besides those two main events, or two events are coming up, I think that I'll also mention that after the event tonight, we're also going to be having a social event, just a get-together at Buffalo Wild Wings, starting at about 9:30. And for anybody who would like to continue talking with either Jerry or anybody else here, feel free to stop by then. At this time, though, I think I'll turn over the mic to Jen, and she'll introduce her speaker.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jennifer Behan. I'm the Assistant Director of Center for Inquiry Michigan, and I have the great honor of working with all of our great student groups across the state to help them organize and put on some events that they probably wouldn't be able to do otherwise. And it's a lot of fun, and I love working with you guys, and thank you for inviting us to be a part of this event. We are very sad that Nate Phelps wasn't able to join us. He's fine. He's got some stuff going on that he just couldn't walk away from, but we will rebook him, don't worry. So Center for Inquiry has very similar goals to SSA. If you're not familiar, I just wanted to tell you our mission statement really quick. We are working to foster a secular society based on science, reason, freedom of inquiry, and humanist values. And so at CFI Michigan, we are working to create a community, just like SSA, where individuals from diverse backgrounds can come together and share life and learn and share life-enriching experiences. So we are a member-based organization, so if you have some extra money, if you can help us support our programs, that's great, but not tonight. You're going to have to email me later. If you need the address for Buffalo Wild Wings, stop by the table at the end and we'll help you get that. Before I introduce our speaker this evening, I want to let you know about some of the Center for Inquiry Michigan programs that we have throughout Southeast Michigan. We have a group called Cafe Inquiry, called Cafe Inquiry that meets in Livonia on the fourth Sunday of each month at Panera Bread, and in Dearborn on the first Thursday of the month. at the Starbucks. They're changing, so check the website. They're changing the location on the first Sunday in the evening. Sorry, first Thursday in the evening. We also have right here in Ann Arbor, we have a Living Without Religion support group. And you might hear Jerry talk tonight about the Recovering Religionists support group. Same thing, just our version of that. So if you have a friend or family or yourself, you need to go and get some stuff off your chest, you can come and talk to some other people and see what they have to say about the experiences that they've been through. And if you guys are on our Facebook or our emails, you've seen we have a billboard up right now in Detroit. It's on I-75, just south of 12 Mile Road. And on the 18th, Friday the 18th, if you guys can carpool up there, we are going to go take a flash mob style picture. We just show up, we're going to go up on the little catwalk thing and go take a picture and get as many people that we can there for that picture. So I'll be working with the SSA kids to help you guys carpool up there. And we also just got these cool t-shirts, and walk over here for a sec. It says, "I'm one of millions living without religion," which goes along with our billboard that says, "Millions of Americans are living without religion." So check that out. We've got some cool graphics on Facebook. You can put out your cover photo and help us spread the word. If you're a student tonight, you can get a t-shirt for $10. Everybody else, it's $15. And the proceeds from that just go to help us do great programs like this. And after the group photo, we're going to go up to that's Benton Royal Oak. We're going to drive a little bit ways over to Sterling Heights to Red Hot and Blue for a Skeptics in the Pub event, which is just a social event where we're going to hang out. We also have one of those here in Ypsilanti, actually this coming Thursday, at the Corner Brewery. And then we also have one in Lansing and Flint, so check our website for that. And then the final thing is the student group at Grand Valley, CFI Grand Valley, was able to secure Neil deGrasse Tyson for November 13th, and tickets are going to be free. So yes, please scream, shout. They did a fantastic job. They have been working with us very closely to get everything squared away. Tickets will be available November 1st. But if you are definitely interested in going, email me, and I will put you on my short list and make sure that you definitely get a ticket. But there's like 5,000 seats, so don't worry. A lot of people will be able to come. All right, please remember to turn off your cell phone so it doesn't disrupt the event. And we have copies of Jerry's book out in the lobby that you can purchase this evening, and he will be happy to sign that for you after the event. With that, I am pleased to introduce Jerry DeWitt. He's an author, public speaker, secular minister, and the vice president of Dogma Debate, LLC. He also sits on the board of the Clergy Project and the Foundation Beyond Belief. His Christian ministry began at age 17, and he evangelized the United States and assisted in three Pentecostal churches, and then later was a pastor of two fundamentalist congregations. After 25 years of ministry, he realized he'd become an atheist, and he will tell you the details of that part of his story. He has made numerous appearances on major news outlets, including New York Times, CNN, The Joy Behar Show, and MSNBC's Morning Joe. Currently, Jerry is working on two projects. He started a secular church community named the Community Mission Chapel near his hometown in Lake Charles, Louisiana. And he is touring with his memoir, Hope After Faith, which was released this June. And he has one son, and he still lives in rural Louisiana. Brave man. Please welcome Jerry DeWitt.
Good evening. I'm going to get this out of my way since I have the other mic going on. Whenever I was in elementary school, I'm going to tell you a little something about myself that may change how you think about me if at the moment you're thinking good about me. But I'm a huge Elvis Presley fan. Any Elvis Presley fans at all? Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay. We'll all meet and get in our rocking chairs and talk about the good old days and afterwards. I'm a huge Elvis Presley fan. And when I was in elementary school, one of his last concerts happened in a town that's about an hour and a half away from my hometown. And my mother took me. It was probably one of the best gifts that she ever gave me. A huge Coliseum. Huge. huge coliseum with lots and lots and lots of seats. But Elvis's career was on the downcline, and so everyone had to sit very close. And I know now that Elvis is better than I am because they put up curtains to hide all the empty seats for him. So with that, I will say thank you for attending tonight, and thank you for not being an empty seat. Thank you for showing up. This is an absolute beautiful facility. And I'm a huge supporter, of course, of CFI and of SSA. And I'm new to this. This is new to me, to know of the secular movement, to know of the secular world, to even know of the secular philosophy is new to me. And to be able to build relationships with these fine groups and these leaders and to see how they're changing the world and making the future better, I'm excited about this. I'm excited about the potential. I'm excited about what we're doing. Are you excited about what the future holds and what you're involved in? I think you should be. So the question is, I'm now 44 years old, saw Elvis a long time ago. The question is, how is it that I stayed in the ministry for 25 years? Whenever I was in Austin, Texas, I guess it may be the end of last year, I was going through my normal spiel and I said, it took me 25 years to become an atheist. And someone yelled out, "You're a slow learner." And I don't think I am. I don't think I'm a slow learner. I think that I'm a person. I think I'm a person that possesses a certain way of looking at life, a certain set of experiences, and a certain value to the world that no one else can replace. So what I want to talk about for the next few moments is how it is that a person, a thinking person, a sincere person, can stay in religion for as long as some of us have and do, if that's all right. So, first I want to read from my memoir very quickly. Page 157, Hope After Faith, for sale, outside. You laugh, I don't get any money from it, it's to support these fine organizations, so. But on page 157, before I start reading this, I want you to understand that as a young minister, a young husband with a 3 or 4 year old son, I was desperately trying to find my place in the world and find my place in the religious world. And I tried that through various means, even different denominations and different churches, but through an odd set of circumstances, literally through a radio broadcast. It's not in the book, but I'll tell you the quick story of it. I made a wonderful friendship with a Cajun minister by the name of Johnny Thibodeau in Doosan, Louisiana. And everything about Johnny was just exactly like his name sounds. Johnny Thibodeau was this Cajun. He actually looks a lot like Professor Farnsworth off of Futurama, but that's different. But Johnny Thibodeau was a beautiful, beautiful person. And he and I were very close friends. And late one night, Johnny was trying to find something to do because as Pentecostals, we were not allowed to watch television or to go to the movies or be involved in anything secular that we refer to as part of the world versus being of God or of the kingdom of God. Johnny Thibodeau was flipping channels on his radio and heard a broadcast that was airing out of Little Rock, Arkansas. But the origin of the program was from Des Moines, Iowa. And this preacher, at first, Johnny resented everything about it. The preacher spoke slow and deliberate and very authoritative, and there was nothing entertaining about his delivery or his message. And he talked in a way that Johnny had never experienced before. And the doctrine that he promoted was completely foreign to Johnny and, of course, to myself, because Johnny and I were from the same background. But the longer that Johnny listened, the more intrigued he became, because Johnny, like I, had lots of questions. Believe it or not, religious people do end up with questions. And so it sounded as if this minister, coming by way of Little Rock from Des Moines, Iowa, was answering these questions in his radio program. And so over a series of events, believe it or not, I ended up moving 1,000 miles away from my home to move to Des Moines, Iowa, and to sit as a student minister under this voice that had come out of Des Moines. Because like Johnny, I had come to believe that this man had answers to very important questions. So we've been there for 8 months. I'd never experienced snow like I'd experienced in Des Moines. Matter of fact, in that early October when we drove up, it was a huge snowstorm. It was the worst winter that that they had had in 33 years. And here I am in this little white Ford Aerostar van, an Aerostar van that was so wore out that the sliding door, we had placed duct tape over the sensors so that the red light wouldn't flash on the dashboard continuously, right? Anybody had a car that jumped up? And so here we drove 1,000 miles and we'd sold everything we had, and what we couldn't sell, we'd given away, all to be under this man's ministry. Now, technically, I was a grown man myself. That's the point I want you to keep in your mind. I was a grown man. I was near my 30s at that time. I was already married, already had a child, had already had jobs, already had responsibilities, had already been in the ministry myself, but yet I was willing to uproot my entire life, my entire family, to go and sit under the teaching of this man. Because I thought he possessed something that I didn't possess, or knew something that I didn't know. And over the course of 8 months, my wife had become extremely disenfranchised with the entire experience and decided that she was going to go home and take my son back to Louisiana with or without me. And this was obviously an extremely dark and stressful time in my life. So starting at page 157, as I wrestled with the meaning of my unanswered prayers, Brother Vernon, this is the main preacher's brother, Brother Vernon bore down on me and urged me to confess to Brother Goodwin, the voice from Des Moines, to confess to Brother Goodwin that I was contemplating leaving the church. Now, these are all grown men, and I'm one of them. But in order to make this life decision, I need to talk to the pastor. So I made an appointment to see Brother Goodwin on a Monday afternoon in the spring of 1996. When I had a day off from preferred risk, a Gospel Assembly Church convention was planned for that May, which only ratcheted up my fears about the meeting with Brother Goodwin. It would seem remarkably faithless to break from the church just before such an important event. When I walked into Brother Goodwin's office, I knew that he was already aware that Kelly and I were considering leaving the church. The gossip mill churned relentlessly in Des Moines, and the news of our decision-making had spread far and wide among the ministry. There was also a sense that any news about the ministers needed to be reported immediately back to the apostle. And that's what we call Brother Goodwin. He was higher than a pastor, higher than a bishop. He was an apostle in our eyes. After taking a seat on a brown leather love seat in the office, I laid out Kelly and my plight anyway, because I wanted Brother Goodwin to feel that I was being fully honest with him. I wanted Brother Goodwin to feel what I was going through and how sincere I was with this. So I said, Kelly wants to go home and she's going to take Paul with her. Staring at him from the love seat where I had my elbows on my knees, Brother Goodwin sat silently behind his desk, straightened his back, and looked back at me and said, let her go. Now, in order to fully appreciate this moment, you have to understand that 1 month before I turned 3, my dad killed himself in a drunk driving accident. And so all of my life, even though my mother remarried a year or so later, all of my life, there was this vacuum in my psyche. There was this, I hope I can use emotional terminology and you don't run out screaming or catch on fire or whatever these atheists do. In my heart, there was this vacuum. Because my dad, David DeWitt, a man that when I think of him, now what I picture is a picture. Because he was gone before I turned 3 years of age. It seems as if I can remember sitting outside of the funeral home, being consoled by my mother's brother, my Uncle Fred. It seems as if I can remember that, but maybe I don't remember it. Maybe it's just that's what I was told, and that's why I seem to possess that memory. But the reality of it is that when my stepdad came into my life, he was a foreigner. He was from another family, and he possessed another name. And because of the relationship between my mom and my stepdad, that intimate fatherly connection was never completely made. And I lived my entire life with this vacuum of looking for my father's approval. Obviously, I now know this somewhat after the fact. So when I'm sitting on that love seat in Des Moines, Iowa, in this very nice church office, pouring my heart out to Brother Goodwin,
there is a very deep-rooted and personal reason that I'm doing this. I'm not doing it because I think somewhere the Bible simply tells me to. I'm not doing it just because there's a tradition. I'm not doing it because I saw it on television or in a movie. I'm not following anybody else's life pattern. What's happening is I'm living out of my own heart. I'm moving along a path that's being created like a river that's cutting through the sand. I'm being me. This is me. And the reason that that's so important to understand that is because when suddenly we jump in front of someone's religious experience, it's as if we're one brick of a dam trying to turn all at once their entire being. Their religious experience is their experience. And one argument, or one good debate, or one YouTube video, or one great book, which is for sale out there, is not necessarily going to stop that river of their life. There's a reason that they are where they are. And there's a lot of momentum behind them. There's a lot of personal experience behind them. And as a grown man sitting on that leather love seat, looking at this man that was now in his 70s, the reason that I'm surrendering my choices and my decisions to him, they don't start with me knowing him. They don't even really start with me thinking that I had come to know Jesus. They start all the way back from the beginning of my life. That's how complicated and integrated religion is in people's lives. I feel a little preaching coming on. I know y'all think I'm already preaching, but you just don't know. So, he says, let her go. I've already lost my dad, and what this has created in me is this vision. I possessed in this vision. I remember we had an extra class that we could take in high school, and it was the teacher was Colonel Fairbanks, and he was an Air Force pilot. And for some reason, mostly because we just goofed off a lot in the class, and that's because that's what he wanted to do. It was an aeronautics class in high school. He asked us to write out what our perfect vision of the future was. Do you know what mine was? Mine was a 9-to-5 job with a Ford pickup and a trailer house. And I know technically they're not trailer houses anymore. They're modular homes. I understand that. And a wife and son who would greet me at the front door when I got in from work. Because that had been taken away from me through this drunk driving accident. And so I'd spent my whole life thinking that there was some way to recapture this, to bring this back together. And so now this man speaks from across his office and says to me, let her go. Brother Goodwin must have seen the shock come over my face. I'd never worked for a minister who would have divided a family for any reason. But Brother Goodwin was undeterred and continued, almost as though he was prophesying. He said, if it's God's will for you and her to stay together, she will go back to Louisiana, she will fall on hard times, and she may even have to enter prostitution to survive. But she'll come back, and then you will be in the driver's seat. If it's not God's will for you, if it's not God's will for you all to stay together, God will give you another wife and another son. Brother Goodwin could tell I wasn't buying his explanation. So he picked up the Bible from his desk. I'll leave you right there. Almost 30 years old, sitting on this love seat, waiting for Brother Goodwin to walk across the room with his black leather-bound Bible in his hand, to now explain to me, through God's Word, why his opinion of my situation is legitimate. And even though it must have even been obvious to him that I wasn't buying it, still yet I was still sitting there. I didn't jump up when he said, let her go, and say, F you, and walk out. Right? Like maybe some of you might have. I was still listening. I was still absorbing. And the reason that I was because there was a true a true lack of understanding within my mind of the importance of the individual, of the value of the single individual. Not just me, but of everyone, of every one of us. I had spent a lifetime within the realm of religion trying to find that fatherly approval, trying to find that fatherly acceptance. I mean, it's not hard to look even further out into my psyche and to see that so much of my quest for trying to find God and to love God and to know God and to be known of God was just that, this desire of trying to receive some fatherly approval. You see, I know this is off text just a little bit, but stay with me. I'm persuaded that what the secular movement is doing is far beyond just trying to convince people that religion is a mythology like all other religions or all other mythologies. I think it's bigger than that. I think it's greater than that. I think what we're doing by being involved in the groups that we're involved in is far more special and far more intimate than just even battling for separation of church and state, as important as that is. What we're doing is we're fighting for the rights, all rights, of each and every individual to stand up and understand completely and wholeheartedly their individual worth, regardless of who they are, what they look like, or what they believe. That's what we're really doing here. Because that would have solved the problem all the way back. Had that 3-year-old grown up in a home that would have instilled that appreciation for that individuality, would have instilled that value and that sense of self-worth from the very beginning, then the vulnerability may have never been there for religion in the first place. Does that make sense? It makes sense for my life. It makes sense of why time after time, pastor after pastor, I was looking in their eyes. I was listening to their voices, trying to sense approval, deep, deep-seated approval. And so, for a lack of better words, a miracle has happened in my life. Something incredibly marvelous has happened in my life. Once news began to get out that here was this Pentecostal preacher that now is an atheist, he's done these horrible, almost criminal things like change his Facebook status to secular humanist. Isn't that just obscene? And he's been in our faces by posting on his wall a picture of him, his son, and Richard Dawkins together. What's his purpose? What's his point? Why is he torturing us believers by putting this on his wall? Doesn't he know how it offends us when he puts things on his wall? Right? And it brought this firestorm. Eventually, my wife leaves. Eventually, many, almost all of my family disowns me. Friends, of course, along with them. I'd taken a secular job, a non-religious job, and I was fired from it because just being associated with me could have possibly doomed this particular company and our little religious community. The favor that I'd built, not just religiously, but from working at City Hall as our mayor's chief of staff, all of that went completely down the tubes instantly when people begin to hear and then begin to look up. Oh, it was fun. I'm telling you, talking about a fun week. When I started getting all these friend requests on Facebook, right? Because they wanted to see my stuff. And I could almost pinpoint where the gossip was at in town, depending on which particular office started flooding me with Facebook requests, right? I would know that now that guy had ran over to this realtor's office because everybody in that realtor's office was now friending me all at the same time, wanting to see. And I would watch it for just day after day, people friending me, just so they could come on and see, was it really true? Like slowing down by a car wreck. Right? And I know you do it. I do it. It's just human nature. And I probably would have done it if the shoe had been reversed or on the other foot. I would have looked at it too because it's such a bizarre, bizarre thing to have happen. But all of this loss did something fantastic for me. Because from such an early age, I developed This habit of trying to please everyone. Trying to make everyone in my world happy. Trying to make everyone in my world like me. And by pleasing everyone, I was really not ever pleasing anybody. Because all of those jokers are fighting among themselves. It'd make you want to just have one large meeting, bring everybody in the world together and say, now, what the hell do y'all want from me? Let's just vote. Majority wins. I'll do that. But y'all are pulling me in every direction. And that's what was going on throughout my entire life. And when I was preaching, when I would get behind that pulpit, one of the things that's so energizing about Pentecostalism or the charismatic movement, the charismatic service, is when I would be behind what we refer to as that sacred desk, or I might would come out and be dramatic at a point in my message, suddenly the crowd might stand on their feet and cheer. They weren't necessarily cheering for me, but they kind of was. But, you know, it was really towards Jesus, but I kind of intercepted emotionally, you know, pull some high direction. Jesus never complained, not one time. Seriously, never did. And I would feed off of that. I'd feed off that approval. I'd feed off that acceptance. And afterwards, people would come and say, that was the best message I ever heard. You did such a great job. And I was feeding off that. And I was trying to fill up this empty spot that my dad, David DeWitt, was supposed to have filled up. But he was gone. And so no matter what love I got from anyone or everyone else, it could never fill that spot. Does that make sense? But I wasn't aware of it. I didn't know about it. I didn't understand why I was doing what I was doing. As I was studying the Bible and making my way through religion, I was convinced that I was a servant of God, that I had been chosen by God, and that God was using me to bring about a greater and clearer truth. Maybe he is. We'll see. But I really thought I was on this path, that I was ordained of God to do something special. But no matter who I pleased, no matter where I went, what I did, it didn't ever stop this addiction of trying to please people. And so the magic of being publicly outed, and the magic of losing family and losing friends and losing favor, even though it put my home into foreclosure and I only saved it by filing the stupid kind of bankruptcy where you pay everybody back. The only reason that I saved the things that I saved was through great sacrifice. Great, great, great sacrifice, but losing everything. It set me free. It brought this awareness. That great level of rejection brought this awareness to me. It was as if my life suddenly had me face to face against a mirror where I had to truly examine my motives in the most intimate detail, because now everything was on the line. And so somewhat in secretly, before the news really broke, I found out that Annie Laurie Gaylor from the Freedom From Religion Foundation was going to be speaking down in New Orleans about 3.5 hours from my home. She was going to be speaking for the humanists down there. So I snuck down there to see her. And I attended one of my first meetings of that kind. And it was great. Sitting with everyone. I've never really been that dogging religion kind of person. But just, you know, I mean, shoot, I'm sitting next to an evolutionary biologist, you know. I mean, you know, here was Dave from the humanist group. And I'm able to ask him these questions that I've never been in a room with someone to ask those kind of questions about. And everything about it was interesting and wonderful and uplifting and connecting. And suddenly now I was starting to find people that I was connecting with that I'd never connected with before. I could see myself in them and my life's course within them. And then Annie Laurie Gaylor ruined it all. She turned to me. She put her fork down. I'll never forget. She put her fork down and she says, have you ever had Annie Laurie speak for you? She's a lot of fun. She's very soft-spoken. She says, Dan, her husband, Dan Barker, co-founder, also ex-minister from 30 years ago. She puts her fork down. She says, Dan is going to call you. He would like for you to be on our radio show. Well, see, it was all kind of secret up till then, right? And I was kind of getting away with it. I'd stopped pastoring. I'd stopped taking new places to preach. I was working my way slowly into this new community. And now all of a sudden the offer was being made. The question was being asked. Would you be willing to be public about what's going on in your life? And of course, my desire to please everyone bubbled up to the surface and said, oh, sure, yeah, let me give you my phone number. Have Dan call me, no problem. I'll be glad to do it on the inside. I'm like, oh, shit, this is bad. But on the outside, oh, yeah, I'd be glad to. So we set a date. And the night before I am to do the interview, he's just going to call me. He and Andy Laurie are just going to call and we're going to talk. And he says, Jerry, it's no big deal. It plays live in New York and some other cities. But, you know, probably nobody in your part of the world is going to hear it. Oh, and by the way, it is a pretty popular podcast. But, you know, probably nobody's going to hear it. And the night before that interview, I could not sleep. Something is conflicting inside of me. I know that I want to do this. I know I should do this. But yet, I've got all of these other issues. And it's at that moment that I realized there was only one reason and one reason only for me not to do the interview. It's because I didn't want the rejection that I feared would come afterwards. And that was the night of the epiphany that almost everything I'd done up to that moment, almost every sentence that I'd spoke, every move, even small moves, not just small steps, but large moves all the way to Des Moines, every sermon that I had crafted, every time that I had counseled, every step along my life's journey had the intention of trying to please someone and thus receive their approval. And now I was going to jeopardize every bit of that over one radio program. And I realized in that moment that this was really about me loving me. It was about me loving me. It was, did I love myself enough? Did I love my own integrity? Did I love my journey, my experience, my understanding, all of these beautiful ideas that had come to me, all the things that I'd studied and the conclusions that I'd come to? Did I love me enough to allow myself to be rejected by everyone else? And obviously you know the answer, or I wouldn't be here tonight. And therein, I know you love to talk about how all those animals won't fit on the ark. I know that's a lot of fun. I understand it, but I've said it 100 times, I'll say it again. Nobody comes to Jesus because they did the math and they think the animals will fit. It's not it. That's not the fallacy of religion. The fallacy of religion is not that it still possesses, you know, mythologies that are the equivalent to trying to explain lightning by Thor's hammer. That's not the major, the real fallacy of religion. That's not the reason that I'm here and that I've invested my life in talking to groups like you, hoping that it makes its way through YouTube and through the book that I've written and out into the greater world. The hope for the future is not destroying all mythologies. The hope for the future is raising a generation of people that love themselves. That's the hope for the future. Because when you truly love yourself, two wonderful things happen. The first thing happens is that those vulnerabilities that religion plays upon are cured. Because so much of religion is about the guilt cycle. You grow up feeling disconnected. You grow up feeling this aloneness that is the human experience, right? No matter how much I want to be one with you, no matter how close we ever get, I'm still me, right? And I'm still separated. I know on the quantum level, I understand all of that. But the human experience carries this innate separation and loneliness. I can only see the world through my own set of eyes. And so this inability to truly love ourselves and to appreciate our own value, we grow up with that in America. We start off with that, and then when religion comes in and says, you know, that little gut-wrenching feeling you feel in the dead of night when everyone else is asleep, but you're still awake, and you feel lonely, and you don't feel worthy, and you don't feel good. What that is, that's guilt from sin, and Jesus Christ has paid the price for your sins. And when you get saved, when you enter into that religious experience, in the beginning, you think differently, and thus you experience different emotions. And it seems as if you are cured and that it does go away and you do feel whole and you do feel cleansed and you do feel better. But then real life sets back in and the newness wears off. And all of those people in the sanctuary that used to look like angels, now you can point out the devils because you know them now. And now religion becomes very, very personal and you're back on your own journey and the separation exists again. But it wasn't that there was guilt. It wasn't that there was something inherently wrong with you. As a matter of fact, it's just the opposite. There is something inherently right about you. Because there is only one you. And as far as we know, there will always only be one you. And that makes you right. Now, if you're a serial killer, we may have to contain your rightness in a small 10 by 10 space. But there's value in this uniqueness in being the one and only you. The second thing that it does, the second thing that loving yourself does, is it allows you then, for the first time, to actually fulfill some of the humanistic objectives that do exist within religion. That second of the great commandments. Jesus said the first was to love God with everything. That's the part that screws it up. But he said the second is likened to the first. That you love your neighbor as yourself. But religion doesn't let you love yourself. Religion says, Christianity in particular, that actually you're so unlovable that God had to beat his son to death to make up for how bad you were. Oh yeah, he loved you so much he did that, but still... he couldn't get over it until somebody died. But what we're doing, this ability of standing up for same-sex marriage, this ability for standing up for people that come from different gender persuasions, this ability to stand up for women's rights, this ability to stand up, to say the A word out loud. Still, whenever Jennifer was given the introduction and said when he came out as an atheist, it still almost catches me off guard. I almost want to make a joke and say, who said that? Who's calling me that? It's not about atheism, and it's not, all these things are valuable and worthwhile, but it's about individualism. It's about a future where people grow up, and even if they lose their dad 1 month before they're 3 years old, even if that's the case, the world that they grow up in fills that void and says, you are worthy. You are the only you there is, and that makes you more valuable than gold. So, what I challenge you to do tonight is to continue to do exactly what you're doing. When there's a meeting, show up. When you've got some money, share it. When there's someone you can talk to, talk to them. You've got to plan out your own course of action. I'm not saying that if your mom and dad's paying for school right now that you need to drive home right now and say, Jerry DeWitt said for me to tell you. No. Get your school first. But be you. Be you. Take it from a person. People look at my story and they think that I'm this fearless person. But it's just the opposite. I'm not here because I was fearless. I'm here because I lived in terror my entire life. I'm not here because I stand up for what I believe all the time. I'm here because I tried to please everyone all along the road. And it brought me to this place. I'm not here because I'm so lovable. So tall and handsome and good looking. You didn't laugh. I love you so much. Each one of you are coming home with me. I'm here because I've been rejected. And I'm telling you, the other side of rejection, when you have to do it, I'm not telling you to be suicidal with your reputation. I'm not telling you to destroy your life. You have to plot your own course. That's part of being you. When everyone else around you is coming out and you don't think it's best for you to come out, that's part of you not coming out when everyone else is. It's different for each and every individual, but only you know that in your heart. Only you know if you are being you.
But on the other side of that rejection is freedom. There's not just hope after faith. That's the title of a marvelous book. That's for sale outside. On the other side of rejection is hope. Hope of being you. Thank you. I have no idea how long that was, if that was long enough, so we'll have to make up the difference. So, I think we'll take questions. It's all yours. Do what you got to do. We got plenty of time. So how long did I go? 2 hours? I did talk for a whole hour? Awesome. And nobody got up and left. That's awesome.
So just to tell everyone, if any of you have questions you'd like to ask Jerry, we have microphones set up right here and also one down the front right of the stage. And so feel free to come up and ask questions.
Please ask questions. It's my favorite part. I'll repeat your question if that's okay. She's in the middle of this.
I had the pleasure of spending 14 months in Louisiana I came home in June, but we won't go into that. So I'm familiar with the area, Fort Polk, DeRidder, just less than an hour from Fort Polk. But tell us, I had no idea you were down there.
Right.
Tell us about this church.
Yeah. All right. So the question is about our secular congregation. We try to avoid the word church when we can. Sometimes we get lazy and we just say it. Sometimes we say it for the fun of it, just to mess with people. But we call it a secular congregation. We definitely never refer to it as an atheist church. That's what the media loves to call it, because that gets all kind of fun attention and causes controversy. So here's the thing. In Louisiana, I can't speak for every part of the world, but in Louisiana in particular, our part of Louisiana, church is not a subculture. It is the culture. It is going to be one of the first one or two questions that someone asks you whenever they meet you. You know, it's going to be, what's your name? Where do you go to church? Who's your mama? You know, that's just the way it is. It is a very, very intimate part of being from our part of the world. So what began to happen as I begin to tour at the end of 2011, beginning of 12, I'd give talks like this, and people who come from the same kind of background that I come from, they would kind of enjoy that little bit of that preaching style. And for some people, they were so abused in those types of churches that they might get up and run out. I mean, I've had them cuss me out at the socials afterwards, you know. The way you was talking made me want to puke. Thank you for saying that in front of everybody. But for some people, it's a form of closure for them to be back in that type of environment. And it's just a nostalgic need that exists. So as I traveled, I got a little more comfortable with being my preachery self. And I began to realize there may be this need. And then a free thinkers group from Lake Charles asked me, would I be willing to start a secular congregation? Would I come be the pastor? We don't call it pastor, we call it director. You know, just to keep from pissing all of you off. And so they asked if I would do that, and I said that I would. And so what we do is we meet this nostalgic need. If you were to come in, right now we're small and we're meeting at this, you know, hippy-dippy coffee shop. And all the chairs, yes, they all face in a way. Just like this auditorium, this must be a church. This must be religion. There is a God. Yeah, that's how this stupidity rolls out. We'll all face towards the center, and we'll have a live band will come in, and they'll play music. There'll be lots of music throughout the course of the event. I'll get up at different times and say different things, much like regular events that you attend. There'll be moderation. And then, towards the end of the event, I'll give a much shorter, matter of fact, my last message was only 17 minutes long. I'll get up and give, almost as it was, a motivational speech or a pep talk that is based on secular values. And that's pretty much it. Then we end with some music. Somewhere in the midst of it, we may ask people if they have anything they want to say. You know, do they want to talk about something good that happened in their life? So it can have, it's somewhere between a regular meetup, a regular meeting like you're used to attending, and a Unitarian Universalist service. Okay? It's somewhere in between there. And the only reason that it's not a
Unitarian Universalist service is because we do not tip our hat towards supernaturalism at all. You know, and where the Unitarian Universalist mission, though usually their congregations are made up by agnostics and atheists, their mission is still to tip their hat to lots of different traditions, spiritual traditions, and we just say no, no supernaturalism whatsoever. So that's it's kind of like what you've had tonight, maybe a little bit more flamboyant, but with music.
How many people?
I think we've averaged probably around 40 or so. Yeah, and in our little town, that's pretty cool. Now,
daughter moved to Louisiana. She was told, "Can't swing a cat without hitting the church."
Can't swing a cat without hitting the church. Yeah, that sounds about right. And so now, about 3 hours to the west of us in Houston is Mike Alst with the Houston Oasis. And Mike's congregation, they're probably closer to 100 on a regular basis. Now, 100. 100. Sometimes I catch myself at this. But they, you know, he comes from a much more liberal Christian background. And so, I don't know how many, but some of the members of his congregation actually migrated to atheism with him. And so he had a pretty good foundation to start with. So, you know, it's something. But what's important to know about it is that it is for particular people. It's not for everybody. I don't see it as the next wave to take over the secular movement, or that it's what everybody should do, or that every group should have a church service. It meets a nostalgic need for certain people. So it's just another way of dealing with the needs that exist within the secular movement. And as the demographics continue to grow, as we penetrate deeper and deeper into the South, this is to be expected, that those needs will be exposed and thus met. You want to use the mic? You'll start a good tradition if you do.
My question is, do you find more women in your congregation now? I think my question is because there seems to be such a lack of women in atheism. And I keep saying it's because of this very issue. There's not this soft, warm, humanist congregation where you can listen to good music and hear an inspirational speech like church. And I find it hard to believe. I know there are many women hiding in churches that don't believe. They're there because of family. They're there because of tradition. They're not there because of Jesus.
Right.
So my thought is, I'm wondering if you're seeing more women coming to this congregation, or is that a group that in particular you're trying to attract? Because I see that as a possible way to bring more women to atheism.
Yeah, we were kind of talking along the same subject last night at the social in Grand Rapids. I haven't thought about it. I mean, just standing here thinking about it as you're asking the question, we do have a lot of women. You know, we do. I just thought it was me. You know, that you laugh about. Thank you very much. And so you know, we've got a board of trustees. There's four, and then I make the fifth on this board, and two of them are women. You know, I just don't know. I would be reluctant to answer that without really sitting down and, you know, being a little more factual about it. But I don't feel like it's heavy in one direction or the other. And I know that we do have, and, you know, I mean, we've got a lot of couples. You know, I can't think of maybe one or two gentlemen who come by themselves. You know, I mean, it seems as if the wives are very happy to participate and be there as well. So that there may be something to that. That's very important. And as we, once again, as I said, we were talking about it last night, we do know that normally in religion there are, you know, it's kind of, you know, there's a lot more women. I'm trying hard not to tell the same joke I told last night at dinner with that to keep from boring everybody. I made a horrible mistake during evangelistic service one night. I was trying to connect with the church, and I was trying to, maybe even then, I was a feminist, I don't know, I was trying to, you know, really talk well about the women that was in the congregation. And so my point was going to be there were more women there than there were men in this congregation. I said, if you just look around tonight, you'll see the women outweigh the men. So. So, that's the kind of things that happen when you add it up.
If you don't mind, I'd like to change the topic a little bit.
Okay.
To what you were talking about during the letter. But growing up in religion, one of the things that I talked about with friends was getting to the word you could love yourself, and it was something that I don't know how far we actually got. But from the secular perspective, how would you tell somebody about how to love themselves after growing up in that mindset of knowing that you're so much less?
After growing up, yeah. Well, obviously you're going to have to reverse engineer some of that stuff. You know, you're going to have to, I don't know if you can do it for them, but they are going to have to go back and look at where they got those ideas in the first place and what were those ideas based on. You know, I refer to it as the John the Baptist syndrome in the Gospels. John is quoted as saying, I must decrease so that Christ can increase. And that's really the whole point of Christianity. And to sell it as anything else is pure salesmanship. You know, because it misses the entire point of being a Christian. The whole, right now, if you watch, I pick on him a lot, even though I really do like him, Joel Osteen, he's almost like just a motivational speaker that throws in God and Jesus every once in a while. You know, I don't know if y'all have seen him on television or anything. It runs like 20,000 people in a service. I mean, it's pretty huge. And I feel like that they're disingenuous with the Christian message because he tries to avoid that John the Baptist syndrome about you decreasing so that God can increase. It's all about pumping you up. But even that is flawed in saying that there's something about you that needs to be pumped up. You know, there's something about you that needs to be better. So it's really putting you down without saying it. You know, it's like, come on in here, honey, and let's get you something nice to wear. You know, what the hell? You know, I mean, I thought I was in something nice. And so I really think that individual has to, through their own experience, go back and almost like a record, they have to scratch those grooves. They have to make sure those grooves stop playing in their mind. And many times the only way you can do that is to go back, tear it apart, know that it's all BS, and then be very consistent and intentionally talk good to yourself about yourself. And I know that sounds very hokey, but that's all you've got left is reading and exposing yourself to positive influences. Because the fact of it is that the reason that 30-year-old was sitting on Lord Goodwin's couch and taking all that is because from you know, birth, for 30 years, my programming was being written by my environment. You know, I mean, you ask yourself, especially a lifelong atheist, you know, how does a 60-year-old believe in ghosts? Well, he probably didn't start at age 58. You know, it took 60 years of writing this and literally wiring the brain to look at things that way. So it's a lot of work to be done. It really is. But I'd start with tearing down all those other concepts and then finding positive influences. I hope that answers it to a degree.
Thank you.
Hang on. Since he walked up here with the mic, we'll come to you in a second. Go ahead, sir.
Are you in contact with other atheists who are closeted and still preaching?
You know, the fact that you had to ask that shows I haven't done my job very well. I should have mentioned, how many of you are aware of the Clergy Project? Oh, good. Okay. So the Clergy Project is just exactly what you're talking about. We have, I think the last was 511 members, and about a quarter of those are what we consider to be actives. They are non-believers who are still in the pulpit somewhere or the other, are still in active ministry, but they, most of them want out. They're trying to find a way to get out without, you know, living out the Jerry DeWitt experience and, you know, losing everything. They're trying to save their families and such as that. So yes, we're in constant contact, and there's many, many, many of them. We think there's many more than what we have in the Clergy Project, obviously. So, but y'all know the history of the Clergy Project. Everybody's up to date how it came about. If not, please go to the website and contact Catherine, who's the executive director. So, yes, we are in conversations. And what may surprise some people in the secular movement is I'm not encouraging these ministers to come out at the next big conference. You know, what I'm actually encouraging them to do is what I ended up doing ultimately was what I call identity suicide. I committed identity suicide. Once the problem started getting away from me, I had to be very public with it. And that destroyed that old identity that people knew me as. And so what I encourage them to do is to do what I originally thought I was going to do, which is commit identity starvation. Move away from the ministry gradually, get away from it long enough that you make new relationships, new jobs, new environment, and over time, people don't look at you and say, "Ain't you that guy that used to preach?" You're like, "No, idiot, I'm the guy that washes your car every time." So, but yes, there are many out there. And there's very legitimate reasons. And the majority of the people that I know, they do their dead level best to not get up and lie. You know, it makes it very limited on what they can say. You could say that it's a lie of omission because they're not getting up there and saying completely, you know, what they do now believe to be true. But, you know, there's a whole lot of love your neighbor as yourself messages going on these days. So.
Well, a couple of questions. Is your son an atheist now? And who started to lose their faith first if he is? And is there one particular reason you or him started to lose your faith?
That is a fantastic question. The question was, is my son an atheist now? And which one of us, if he is, became an atheist first? And was there anything that made him lose his faith first, if he did? And the answer is yes, my son is an atheist. Yes, my son did come out before I did. And I think having a dad as a minister was the first thing that made him be an atheist. I really do. We tried very hard to not bring church home with us. Okay, I grew up convinced that the reason that my dad led such a reckless lifestyle that ultimately ended up killing him was because he himself was the son of a preacher. And that it created this inner turmoil that I've been talking about tonight. And so I didn't want that to be on my son. I didn't want my son to feel like that he had to, you know, that he had to live a higher standard. He still did. He still felt that way. There was no way to avoid it. But I tried to spare him as much of that as possible. And no one has ever asked me that or asked him that in my presence. So I don't know what was the very first thing, but I would suspect that, I do know that I had a love for science and that I exposed him to as much science as I could all throughout his life. And I don't know if that eroded away. I don't think he ever truly became a saved Christian the way that... you know, the way that we would have considered him to have. But he may have felt like he did. I really don't know. But he is my hero because he really started standing up for his individualism, obviously before I did, about 2 years or more before I did. And it was truly inspiring to watch him. You know, the first thing he wanted to do is he stopped cutting his hair altogether. Just stopped cutting his hair. It looks like Grizzly Adams. You know, and so here he is coming to church, you know, with long hair and his beard starting to grow. He's about 5 inches taller than me, and you know, he's just this big, robust guy. And then he wanted his ear pierced, and you know, we went for that. And then he wanted a tattoo, and we went for that. You know, and so it was very encouraging to watch him with head held high walk into the family reunion, you know, knowing that people were going to talk about him afterwards. So, he's my hero, 100%. Thank you for asking that. Surely there's more. There's so much more to me to know.
So, I have a question. You mentioned like one of the first or the second things somebody from the town of Louisiana asked you this, you know, about your church and religion. Suppose some heathen like me from the north would wander down there, probably on the way to somewhere other than there.
Right.
And this question comes up at the coffee shop or something. What's the reaction to that going to be if I go completely in? And then related question is, this congregation you got going on in that same small town, how are they received in the larger community?
Very, very good question. So the first part of the question is, if you wandered into our neck of the woods and somebody asked you, "Where do you go to church?" and you told him you was an atheist or whatever, how would they respond? Well, first off, because you ain't one of us, it don't really matter. I mean, that's really the truth. We wouldn't expect anything less from a Yankee. You know, I mean, that's just You know, that's just, I'm being very honest. That would be the feel. I would say, well, that's because of, you know, you being up there from the north. You know, it's where all them damn liberals are at. You know, and so that's what would, I mean, anybody who's from the south, you know, that's exactly the way the thinking would be. See, like, yeah, I've heard about you all my life. Now there's one. Call Jim Bob. Come over. Look, there's a real one. You know? It's like having CNN at your table. And so that's the way we would have felt. You know, it almost wouldn't have counted. You know, in our world, of course, we were fundamentalists, but in our world, there was just believers, and we didn't even really use that phrase a whole lot because it was about how holy you were, you know, but I'm trying to be simplistic. But there was just believers, and then there were unbelievers, not non-believers. In our world, there was no one who had really just sat down and figured out for themselves that they didn't believe. They just hadn't heard me preach yet. That's the only reason they don't believe, is because they just hadn't heard me preach yet. You know, that makes them an unbeliever, but not a non-believer. So the worldviews are so varied and really, really very different. So it wouldn't have been a big deal. You know, they probably would have really went out of their way to be extra nice to you, to be honest. They probably would have felt an obligation to show you the love of God and to go out of their way to be that one example. I don't think you'd be mistreated at all. On the other hand, once word started getting out about our secular congregation, that was not as fun. Because we are them. All right? We are from there. And the general consensus was that we are a tool of Satan and that we are out to steal their children. You know, I don't know what we're going to do with them when we steal them. I do. We're planning on eating them.
That's right.
And, you know, so we're stealing them slowly because you don't want the meat to go bad. That's a lot of freezer space. You steal all of their kids. And so, see, I've got a very sick. Sorry, but it is not appreciated. What we're doing is not appreciated. It's not. But kind of a point of the secular congregation thing is so me and you, we meet at work, and say you're the Southerner, and you say, where do you go to church? And kind of with a giggle on the inside, I say Community Mission Chapel. You know, oh, cool. That's cool. All right, and the subject's dead for the moment. Right. And you and I worked together for a long time, and I'm just a normal guy, and you're a normal guy, and you see good qualities in me, and then somehow later on, you find out Community Mission Chapel is that church trying to steal everybody's kids so they can eat them. And you're like, well, wait a minute, I know Jerry. Jerry, go, what? Maybe I got this atheist thing. Maybe, you know. And so we like the fact that it creates the question. What I've started saying for some time now is I don't claim to be the answer. I don't claim to have the answer. What I know is that I am the question. And as long as I stay in the South, live in the South, stay in my town, then the question stays on the table. You know, because I can move anywhere across the country. I doubt there's a single state in the Union that there's not a place where I could live because people have invited me, you know, over the last 2 years. Matter of fact, what is today? Is today the 10th? I think today is the day that I posted the Dawkins picture on the website 2 years ago. 2 years ago today. And so I could have been anywhere, but if I stay in the South, the question stays alive. Somebody?
All right. Yeah, so you've clearly broken down basically how you came to realize that you need to love yourself and the major fallacy with Christianity and religion. And how kind of it's how you can come to love yourself after a while, and how it might draw you in from the very beginning. But what my question is, I know some people who lived their whole lives or most of their lives independent of religion, and later came to it and kind of devoted like completely to it. And my question is whether you've come across that, what your thoughts are on that. As opposed to...
Sure, yeah, obviously, yeah, you're exactly right. This is one of the things that, you know, you have to always be careful with in giving presentations, is it's only fun if you make it sound like it's universal, you know, so that it has the emphasis, you know, given to it, but obviously it doesn't fit everyone all the time. So there have been numerous cases that I've seen where people, you know, later on in life, middle-aged or even elderly people have... come to the Lord after a lifetime of not doing so.
What you have to do is you have to step back and you have to look at a couple of things, and you have to, if you can go back into their history, it's interesting, and it's not always the case, but in some cases, there was a seed planted early on in their life that's really been there the entire time. And maybe life has, you know, taken them in a different direction. They've been able to ignore it. They've been interested in other things. And then suddenly an event in their life, something shifts, something changes in their life. And that idea of you should be a church person or you should be a religious person is then to be dealt with. That's just one scenario. You know, what the case that I try to make is that the United States is religious. It doesn't have a religion within it. It is religious. Our culture is religious. No matter how secular you are being religiously affected at some point in time because it's so embedded in the American culture. And so how have they been affected and maybe not even been aware of it as they go through the course of their life? But other cases, I've seen people, I know